Hello and welcome, and thank you for joining with us today here at Warragul Anglican Church in the beautiful Gippsland region of Victoria, Australia. We're pleased that you're with us today, and we're looking forward to a service inside. It'll be a service out of the Anglican Prayer Book for Australia. Perhaps you are a through and through Anglican and you've got a prayer book at home. That's great. You'll be able to use that. If you don't, it's great to have you with us. We're going to put all the prayers, all the Bible readings, all the responses up on the screen as we move through the service. I'm the Reverend Tracy Lowerson, and I have the great privilege of leading the church here in Warragul. And I'm so pleased that you've joined with us today. I hope that the service is a real blessing for you. Let's go in.
Love to
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Glory to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as in the beginning, so now, and forever. Amen. The opening canticle. O come, let us sing out to the Lord. Let us shout in triumph to the rock of our salvation. Let's come before his face with thanksgiving and cry out to him joyfully in psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the peaks of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, and he made it. His hands moulded dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down and kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is the Lord our God. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Today, if only you would hear his voice. Do not harden your hearts as Israel did in the wilderness. When your forebears tested me, he said, put me to proof though they had seen my works. 40 years long, I loathed that generation and said, it is a people who err in their hearts, for they do not know my ways, of whom I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Let's be not like those people. The night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart, one mind. Lord, as we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. We're going to have our Bible readings now, our sermon for the week, and some prayers.
Our reading for today is from Matthew chapter 6, verses 9 to 15. This, then, is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I'll now invite Peter, who's going to share the sermon today.
Interesting that Dick had problems with his computer, and apparently Andrew had problems with his computer. And the thing we have in common, quite apart from the fact that we're all quite old, is that I had problems with my computer too. The problem wasn't the computer, the problem was me, actually, because it's actually a new computer, and I didn't know where Word was on it, so I had to handwrite it. Which I can still do. Right, continuing our series on the Lord's Prayer. And today particularly, honing in on what this prayer teaches us regarding forgiveness. Us forgiving others as well as being forgiven by others ourselves. Matthew 6, verse 12 tells us to forgive us the wrongs we have done as we forgive the wrongs that others have done. And then a few verses on in 14 and 15, if you forgive others the wrongs they have done you, your Father in heaven will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, then your Father will not forgive the wrongs you have done. I think there's no doubt there'll be people in the audience, in our congregation today, who know someone who's proven hard to forgive. Someone who's caused hurt to you, to a loved one or to a good friend. And at least weekly, perhaps more often than that, we pray the words, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. But even still, for many of us, there are some situations that are seemingly unforgivable. And sadly, so often this unforgiving involves family or a once close friend. A week or so ago, Lynn and I were trawling through Chromecast on our TV, looking for, I'd done an endless list of movies that we'd never seen before, and came across one called The Straight Story. It's called The Straight Story because it's about a fellow called Alvin Straight. True, yes. I mean, and it's a story so ridiculous that it has to be true. It's too ridiculous to be fiction. You know, this really has to be true, and it was. Happened in the late 70s in one of the very poor parts of Central America, USA, but the sort of wheat belt there in the Midwest. And Alvin is a very incapacitated widower. He has hip and knee problems so bad that he has to walk with two sticks, and, you know, strangely, like the wealthiest country in the world, he can't afford to go and get operations. So he literally walks like this with his two sticks. And he hears that his only brother has had a heart attack. His elder brother lives in another part of America. Alvin lives in Ohio, and his brother is many hundreds of miles away. But he gets it in his head, he's got to go and see his brother, because when they were young, in their younger years, in their teen years, they were really good friends. But then as years went by, they lost contact and their relationship soured. And he really, for the life of him, couldn't remember why. And now when he was confronted with the fact his brother might die, and Alvin himself is very old as well, he can't let the opportunity go. He wants to go and tell his brother that he forgives him, and hopes that his brother may in turn say that he forgives him. The problem is, as I said, Alvin could hardly walk, and he couldn't drive because he had awful eyesight, so his license had been cancelled. He didn't have very much money at all. And the movie actually opens when he's mowing his lawn on this dilapidated old ride-on mower, a 30-year-old John Deere. And he can drive that, so he thinks to himself, he decides he'll go and see his brother 400 odd miles away on his ride-on mower. This 30-year-old ride-on mower. And he's a very practical sort of fellow, and he manages to build, he's got a little trailer, a little low trailer. He builds like a little shed on the back of this trailer, and that's where he's going to sleep. It's like his little caravan. And he sets off. He has a daughter who lives with him who tries to talk him out of it, but he says, I'm a stubborn old milder. No, I want to do this. If it's the last thing I do, I want to go and see my brother who's 400 odd kilometres away. And the story is about him driving across Central America on this ride-on mower. It takes him 6 weeks, and he drives sort of almost day and night. And when the mower breaks down, and it breaks down a few times, he always seems to be in a little community that it breaks down in, and they help him because they're so sorry for him. And he finds his brother in this dilapidated old shack, and they make up. And when they were kids, they used to love to go out into the garden and look up at the stars. And the movie almost finishes with the two of them holding hands, looking up at the stars. The movie doesn't tell you, but we were interested enough that we got onto the computer and we found out that the brother survived longer than Alvin and actually went back and lived with Alvin for a while. And Alvin died about 2 years 2 years later. But they forgave each other. And it was a happy ending. And it's so sad that when you bring these topics up, there's so many people can say, oh, gosh, I've got a brother or a neighbour or a mother or a son. And, you know, we just haven't made up. I brought the matter up at a Tuesday group that Graham runs over at Druin, and one fellow there said, great Christian guy, but admitted, he said, I got a brother. He said, you know, our relationship broke down over the years, and he said, when I try to phone him, if he notices me, he just hangs up. So sad that we only get one chance at life, don't we, with all our brothers and sisters and so on. So sad that it might end up where we've still got that unforgiven relationship. The biblical scholar, Dr. R.T. Kendall, in his book, The Sermon on the Mount, says that in his view, the greatest need of the church today is the petition before us. That's forgive the wrongs we've done, etc. Many people would agree, he says, and the Lord would certainly agree with them. It's as if at the close of the Lord's Prayer that Jesus has then added a P.S. That's verses 14 and 15. And this is the only immediate comment that Jesus makes on the Lord's Prayer when he brings up forgiveness again and says, if you forgive others the wrong they've done you, your Father in heaven will forgive you, etc. Of all this sort of six petitions that are in the Lord's Prayer, this is the only one that Jesus immediately expounds further on. And that's indicative of how important he sees this. One of Kendall's most popular sermons was entitled Total Forgiveness. And he once preached it to 5,000 people, and about 4,500 came forward when he gave the appeal. And by doing so, of course, they were acknowledging their total forgiveness of anyone in their lives. He goes on that he sometimes believes that if he could preach that exact same sermon 3 weeks later, he would get a similar response from the same people. Because forgiving those who have been unjust, wicked, evil, vile, is the hardest thing in the world to do. Not only that, you have to keep doing it day after day, week after week, perhaps for years. And he admits he struggles in this area himself. He has to keep forgiving all the time. It is so easy to slip and to repeat the same sin. And that's why, he says, the Lord's Prayer needs to be prayed at all time. The Archbishop of Canterbury, Rowan Williams, agrees, and he said, if somebody said, give me a summary of the Christian faith on the back of an envelope, the best thing to do would be to write our Lord's Prayer. All prayer, he says, has to acknowledge our need for forgiveness and our need to forgive. Forgive us our trespasses is in some ways the hardest bit of the Lord's Prayer to pray, because it tells us straight away that to pray is also to be willing to change. And it takes a lot of nerve, he says, to come before God and say, forgive me because I've forgiven someone else. And he says it doesn't always feel he's really up to making that kind of claim on God. But it is saying that it's through God's forgiveness of us that we learn how to forgive. It's in our capacity to forgive that we show we've been forgiven. It reminds us that our own ability to forgive comes from the fact that we're aware of God's forgiveness for us, and that unless that really sinks in, then we'll be incapable of forgiving. And it's no good then turning back to God and saying, forgive me, even though I haven't even begun to hear what forgiveness means and I don't know the meaning of the word. Jesus tells us the very powerful story about the king's servant who's let off his debt, but then goes straight off and puts another servant in prison because he owes him a small amount of money. And he underlines the point there that unless you forgive, you can't receive forgiveness. you've just made yourself incapable of receiving forgiveness. So it's a bit of a vicious circle. If I don't forgive, I can't be forgiven. If I can't hear the word of forgiveness and really let it change me, then I shan't be free to forgive. And so this is quite a sobering prayer about forgiveness. But there's a wonderful image from one of the early church fathers about this. He says, it's a bit like teaching a child to do something. The parent does it carefully a few times, then steps back and says, now you show me. God forgives us and then steps back and says, now you show me how to forgive. I'm going to close with a few lovely words from Lewis A. Drummond and his book, The View from the Cross. He says, forgiveness transcends finite human reason. The mere thought that one's entire sin account can be utterly eradicated is staggering. Yet it is quite clear that the forgiveness of sin strikes at the very core of human need and experience. It speaks of guilt gone, of remorse removed, of depression disappearing, and emptiness of life eradicated. What power there is in forgiveness. And it all comes abundantly from the gracious hand of God. Amen.
Each week at church we pray a prayer of confession, recognising that we fall short of the glory and the righteousness of God, of his great commands, of all that he created us to be, we who are made in his image. I'll read to you some verses of scripture to prepare our hearts for that confession, and then if you'd like to join me in it, the words will come up on the screen. Isaiah 1:18 says this, come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they're red as crimson, they shall be like wool. Or Psalm 32, happy are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Joel chapter 2 verse 13 says this, return to the Lord your God, who is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 16 says this, let's approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. We'll have a moment of silence where you might like to bring before the Lord any particular thing that you'd like to confess and ask his forgiveness about, and then we'll say together the prayer that comes up on the screen. Heavenly Father, you have loved us with an everlasting love, but we have broken your holy laws and have left undone what we ought to have done. We're sorry for our sins and turn away from them. For the sake of your Son who died for us, forgive us, cleanse us, and change us, and by your Holy Spirit, enable us to live for you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God desires that none should perish, but that we all turn to Christ and live. And in response to his call, we acknowledge our sins. God pardons those who humbly repent and truly believe the good news. Therefore, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ. These verses reinforce that forgiveness. Romans 6, verse 10 to 11. Christ died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Or Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4. God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace we've been saved. Or Hebrews chapter 7. Jesus is able for all time to save those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. Let's spend a moment saying the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen. May the God of peace equip you with everything good for doing his will, working in you what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.